I wanted to ask you if you came expecting today. Did you come here expecting? Praise God. That's good. That's good. You know, a lot of times I've been exposed to a lot of big ministries, powerful men and women of God. And a lot of times you get the attitude when you see someone new that you're going to critique them and, you know, what are they like and is the anointing on them? And you sort of get the attitude that it's like showtime at the Apollo. But I don't want you to have that attitude. I'm going to ask you to check your attitude because this is about the Word of God. I want you to take heed to the Word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord has given me a very strong message, and I'm going to ask you not to take notes. I'm going to ask you to listen, because the Word of God says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And I'm expecting change, and the only way there can be change is through faith. Okay? Hallelujah. Most of the scriptures that I've prepared and that the Lord has given me, I'm not going to ask you to turn to because I'm going to be reading a lot of word. I'm going to be covering a lot of ground. There will be some scriptures that I will ask you to turn to, but I don't want you to get all panicky and say, she's going too fast. I've just got a lot of word to deliver. Hallelujah. One last thing I like to sort of tell people about me is that the way I've learned to flow in the gifts is to sort of like Tex-Mex food. I kind of preach and I kind of teach, okay? But I stick close to the Word of God, okay? And I don't come in here with anything else other than the Word of God. Praise God. Before we get into prayer, there are some things that I want to cover. There are some words that I want to cover. I want to make sure you have a clear understanding of my mission here and what you're going to receive today. In John chapter 16, verse 7 through 11, Jesus was talking to the disciples and he told them that it was expedient for him to go away because if he didn't go away, the Comforter couldn't come. And when the Comforter came, one of the things that the Comforter was going to do was going to reprove the world of sin. And the reason why he was going to do that is because they didn't believe on Jesus. Now, if you were to look up reprove in the Greek, it means convict, convince, tell it fault, rebuke. In the plain old dictionary, rebuke means criticize sharply. So reprove means to rebuke or criticize sharply for a fault or misdeed, to scold, to find fault with, or to disapprove. As an evangelist, many people think that an evangelist is a soul winner for Christ, and sometimes you have a concept that that's all they do. You think of Billy Graham when you hear the word evangelist. But that's not all that they do. The Word of God says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 through 5, to preach the word, be in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort, with all long suffering and doctrine. Doctrine, the doctrine that they're talking about there is the doctrine of Christ. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. The thing about rebuke is that you see a human being, and I'm called by God to preach. So when I open my mouth, I'm expecting the Holy Spirit to speak through my mouth. You don't see the Holy Spirit. So I have to minister to you the word of God in a spirit of meekness. Because, but by the grace of God, I could be doing the same thing I'm sent to preach against. So in Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, the word says, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Therefore, I don't come here to judge. I simply come here to deliver the word of God as it was given to me, to you. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24 through 26 says, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. You might be asking, oh, what's going on here? What's getting ready to happen? Why would God be rebuking me? In Revelations chapter 3, verse 19, the word says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5, the word says, my son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he received. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereas all are partakers that are sons, then are ye bastards and not sons. Okay, I would just like you to pray with me right now. We're going to go before the Father. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, I come before you right now and I just worship and I praise you, Lord. I thank you for this day. Father, you know I've prepared, I've written down what you've given me, but I give it back to you right now, Father. And I ask you to just speak through my mouth, Lord God. You created me, you are in control. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I step into my office of an evangelist. And I am committed to obey you and to yield to you, Lord. I bind Satan and every demonic spirit that would come against this word. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you that you're loosing angels right now, Father, so that everything that I need and everything that the people need will be supplied. I'm counting on you to confirm your word, Lord God. And I love you. And I praise you, Jesus. I thank you right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. The message the Lord gave me to preach is entitled, Be Sure Your Sins Will Find You Out. Be sure your sins will find you out. When the Lord began to give me this sermon, one of the first scriptures that came to me was Ecclesiastes 10, verse 1. And if you would, please, I'd like you to turn there. All right. It says, dead flies cause the ointment of the apothecary to send forth a stinking savor. So doth a little folly him that is in reputation for wisdom and honor. Now, that word ointment in the Greek can be translated to mean the anointing. The word apothecary is someone who makes an ointment, perfume, or compound. When God first gave me this message, what was impressed upon my spirit is that there was corruption in the anointing, that somebody was in deep sin, and that there was corruption in the anointing. Let's get into this a little deeper. I'd like you to turn now to Ephesians 5:2. Hallelujah. I'm just praying to the Father. Horabasi. Hele horabasi. Heboramasi. Praise. Starting at verse 2, it says, "And walk in love as Christ also have loved us and have given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them, for ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he saith, Awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. Awake thou that sleepest. For many, or some, or one, whoever this message is to, God has been warning you, almost like a child with a son. Let's say his name is Johnny. And he's come and he's shook the bed and said, Wake up, Johnny. It's time to get up. Got to go to school. But you didn't take heed. Time went by. Parents listen. Doesn't hear Johnny in the bathroom. Goes back to the bedroom. Johnny's still in the bed. God presses on the, or rather the mother presses on the bed a little harder and says, Wake up, Johnny. The bus is about to come. Get up. Johnny still doesn't get up. In like manner, God has been warning you and you haven't taken heed. And then he sent a stronger warning and you haven't taken heed. And so he sent me to say, Wake up! Wake up! Danger is ahead! Wake up! My text is taken from 2 Samuel, chapter 11 through chapter 12, verses to the end of verse 14. I'm not going to ask you to turn there. You can if you like. But I'm going to read to you an account of what happened with David, Uriah, and Bathsheba. I call it David's Dilemma. Now, I'm going to read the first verse from the King James Version, but the rest of it I'm going to read from the Living Bible. Praise God. In verse 1, it says, "And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him, and all of Israel, all God's people. But they destroyed the children of Ammon, and besieged Raba. But David tarried still at Jerusalem." The Lord impressed upon me two things, or actually three things in this passage. At the time when kings go to battle, or you could say at the time when leaders go to battle, David sent somebody else. But that wasn't the worst thing in my mind, because he also sent all of God's people. David didn't realize, he didn't handle the anointing on his life properly. Because in those days, the children of God weren't filled with the Holy Spirit like we are. David was anointed. David carried the fire of God, and he did not handle God's people properly. As I was studying for this, the Lord impressed on me that David had begun to trust in the arm of the flesh. Israel was a humongous nation. It was a lot of people. And he had become complacent. But in Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 5 through 8, it is written, "Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departed from the Lord. For he shall be like the heath in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land, and not inhabit it. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when he cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit." The Lord told me to warn you. Not to lose focus that what you get by the anointing, you have to keep by the anointing. Don't lose focus on that. You can't get it by the anointing and keep it in the flesh. Because if you keep it in the flesh, you'll start manipulating God's people. You'll start utilizing the world system, and you were not created to utilize the world system. God translated you from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to go ahead, and I'm going to continue on, and I'm going to read from the Living Bible. It says, "One night, David couldn't get to sleep and went for a stroll on the roof of the palace." Now remember, I said David was complacent. "As he looked out over the city, he noticed a woman of unusual beauty taking her evening bath." I'm led to just tell you what complacent is real quick. Complacency means to be contented to a fault, self-satisfied, David had succeeded so often that he had become complacent. Sometimes you can be flowing in the Holy Spirit and things just start happening that you get self-satisfied and you think, well, you know, he doesn't remove the gifts and callings, so I got it going on. Okay, are we on one accord here on one page? Okay, now let's go back. One night he couldn't get to sleep and went for a stroll on the roof of the palace. As he looked out over the city, he noticed a woman of unusual beauty taking her evening bath. He sent to find out who she was and was told that she was Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah. Then David sent for her, and when she came, he slept with her. She had just completed the purification rites after menstruation. Then she returned home. When she found that he had gotten her pregnant, she sent a message to inform him. So David dispatched a memo to Joab, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." When he arrived, David asked him how Joab and the army were getting along and how the war was prospering. Then he told him to go home and relax, and he sent a present to him at his home. But Uriah didn't go there. He stayed that night at the gateway of the palace with the other servants of the king. When David heard what Uriah had done, he summoned him and asked him, "What's the matter with you? Why didn't you go home to your wife last night after being away so long?" I like to stop there. You know, in today's times, he would have said, "Man, what's up with you? With a woman as fine as you got, I'd have gone home and got busy." That's what he was saying. That's what he was saying. But see, he was out of place because he shouldn't have been looking at another man's wife like that. Okay? This passage is telling you something about David. It's telling you something about what happens when you become complacent. Okay? Uriah replied. Now, this is what David's attitude should have been, and I found that amazing. He said, "The ark and the armies and the general and his officers are camping out in open fields. And should I go home to wine and dine and sleep with my wife? I swear that I will never be guilty of acting like that." "Well, stay here tonight," David told him, "and tomorrow you may return to the army." So Uriah stayed around the palace. David invited him to dinner and got him drunk. But even so, he didn't go home that night. But again, he slept at the entry to the palace. Finally, the next morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and gave it to Uriah to deliver. How low down. He's going to give him a death notice, and he's going to make him carry it to the commander himself. The letter instructed Joab to put Uriah at the front of the hottest part of the battle and then pull back and leave him there to die. So Joab assigned Uriah to a spot close to the besieged city where he knew that the enemy's best men were fighting. And Uriah was killed along with several other Israeli soldiers, several other of God's people. God's people, you are precious. The people you touch, they're precious. They're precious. They are precious to God. When Joab sent a report to David of how the battle was going, he told his messenger, "If the king is angry and asks, why did the troops go so close to the city? Didn't they know there would be shooting from the walls? Wasn't Abimelech killed at Thebez by a woman who threw down a millstone on him? Then tell him, Uriah was killed too." So the messenger arrived at Jerusalem and gave the report to David. "The enemy came out against us," he said, "and as we chased them back to the city gates, the men on the wall attacked us, and some of our men were killed, and Uriah the Hittite is dead too." "Well, tell Joab not to be discouraged," David said. The sword kills one as well as another. Complacent. Complacent. Fight harder next time and conquer the city. Tell him he's doing well. When Bathsheba heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. Then when the period of mourning was over, David sent for her and brought her to the palace, and she became one of his wives. One thing that came to my mind right here is it says that after she had completed her purification for ministration, then David brought her in. After she finished mourning, that's telling me that David was looking. David was really aware of this woman. This wasn't just a fluke that he was just walking on top of the roof one night and he just sees this beautiful woman. Then when the time of mourning was over, David sent for her and brought her to the palace, and she became one of his wives, and she gave birth to his son. But the Lord was very displeased with what David had done. Going on in chapter 12, it says, so the Lord sent the prophet Nathan to tell David this story. There were two men in a certain city, one very rich, owning many flocks of sheep and herds of goats, and the other very poor, owning nothing but a little lamb he had managed to buy. It was his children's pet, and he fed it from his own plate and let it drink from his own cup. He cuddled it in his arms like a baby daughter. Recently, a guest arrived at the home of the rich man, but instead of killing a lamb from his own flocks for food for the traveler, he took the poor man's lamb and roasted it and served it. David was furious. I swear by the living God, he vowed, any man who would do a thing like that should be put to death. He shall repay four lambs to the poor man for the one he stole and for having no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are that rich man. The Lord God of Israel says, I made you king of Israel and saved you from the power of Saul. I gave you his palace and his wives and the kingdoms of Israel and Judah. And if that had not been enough, I would have given you much, much more. Why then have you despised the laws of God and done this horrible deed? For you have murdered Uriah and stolen his wife. Therefore, murder shall be a constant threat in your family from this time on, because you have insulted me by taking Uriah's wife. I vow that because of what you have done, I will cause your own household to rebel against you. I will give your wives to another man, and he will go to bed with them in public view. You did it secretly, but I will do this to you openly in the sight of all Israel. I have sinned against the Lord, David said. He confessed to Nathan. Then Nathan replied, yes, but the Lord has forgiven you, and you won't die for this sin. That reminds me of 1 John 1:9, where it says, if you confess with your mouth, if you confess your sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. And the last verse says, but you have given great opportunity to the enemies of the Lord to despise and blaspheme him. So your child shall die. Then Nathan returned to his home, and the Lord made Bathsheba's baby deathly sick. It's possible that during the course of the times that God has been warning you and you've not heeded, that things have started to happen in your home. Things have started to happen in your family. You must not take the anointing of God so carelessly. You must guard it. It's God. You've got to love the anointing. You've got to love God. You've got to guard it. You've got to guard it. You've got to passionately guard it. Because if you don't, you'll be insulting him. Okay? I want to talk to you now a little bit about the stages of sin. Everybody, including myself, sins. We make mistakes. Sometimes we know what we're doing, and sometimes we don't even know we've made a mistake. But if your heart is towards God, you're not going to be able to keep doing it, believe me. You won't be able to just do it in ease. You'll repent of that thing real quick. And you'll make it your habit. Some way I got to break out of, nope, I'm not going to do this again, and mean it. But if you don't have a heart towards God, if you possibly have become complacent, that sin can go into the next stage, which the Bible refers to as iniquity. Iniquity could better be understood as a habit. You really like that sin. That's just the truth of it. You like doing it. You haven't matured yet. You've made all kinds of excuses, but God has warned you, but you still do it. I mean, you just like to do it. You just keep doing it. It's a habit. But God is a loving God, and he keeps warning you. And you know in your heart, you know in your spirit, I shouldn't be doing this. But then that thing goes further. And it goes into what is called, the Bible calls, lasciviousness. What lasciviousness is you can't put on the brakes. You know you're doing wrong, but you can't stop. You want to stop now, but you can't stop. Lasciviousness. Lust, the spirit of lust, it takes. Lust can never be satisfied. It drives you. It drives you. And you can't stop because you want more. You want more. And you know it's wrong and it's hurting the heart of God, but you can't stop. But love gives. And God has come today to give to you again his love. And he's asking you, don't take me so lightly anymore. Guard what I have given you. Don't take it so light. Treat it like your when you first fell in love. Treat it like that. Have passion toward God. In Romans chapter 6, verses 12 through 13. It says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Know ye not to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey? His servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death and of obedience unto righteousness. Whoever you choose to obey, that's the servant you belong. You're the servant of that person. If you choose to obey Satan, you are his servant. If you choose to obey God, you are his servant. The word in Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The wages of sin is death. Well, we've all sinned in here. I'm still standing, loud as I can ever be. Just still here. You still here. Well, you know, what's wrong? Did the word lie? No. The wages of sin is death. It reminds me of when Jesus was on the cross. And before he went, he actually got to the cross. He endured, the Bible says, that he endured pain. They pulled his beard. They put a crown of thorns on him. They spit on him. They made him drag his own cross. They beat him. You could hardly recognize who he was. And he didn't say a word. Didn't say anything. But when he was on the cross, and when it was time for God to put all the sins of the world on him, all your sins, all my sins, on him, so he could pay the price, God could not look at him. He had to turn. That's the only time Jesus cried out. And he said, Father! Father! Oh, Lord God, why have you forsaken me? The wages of sin is separation from God. And you don't want to be separated from him. You don't want to be separated from him. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So now, you know about David. So let's just travel through the corridors of time all the way up to the year 2001. Let's see what David's dilemma symbolizes for us today. Let's first talk about the battle. You remember it said when kings go out to battle, when leaders go out to battle, you know that the word tells us in Ephesians 6:12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, it tells us to cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bring it into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. A good example of that would be adultery. Matthew chapter 5, verse 28, it says, but I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. See, David had committed adultery with Bathsheba before he even had her. Okay? Because he was looking on her. Well, the battle today is pornography. You're looking on it. You see it. You might not even be trying to look at it intentionally. It's just on the TV. It's in your face. But instead of you casting it down, you do it again. And then it becomes a habit. And then it becomes a lasciviousness. And the next thing you know, you're in bed with somebody else. And it's not your wife or husband. Complacency. Complacency. You cannot trust in past victories. You cannot have confidence in yourself. You must have confidence in God. And you must do it on a day-to-day basis. His mercies are new every morning. His benefits are new every morning. If you would please turn to Luke chapter 12, starting at verse 45. It says, but if that servant say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to beat the men servants and maidens, and to eat and drink and to be drunken, The Lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him. Why? Because he's got complacent. Okay. And at an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him in sunder. Now the Lord of that servant will come, and that's what's going to happen, and will appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. And that servant, which knew his Lord's will, and prepared not himself, neither did
according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. But he that knew not, and did commit things worthy of stripes, shall be beaten with few stripes. I want to stop right here for a moment and just bring to your attention that there is people saying, well, you know, sin is sin and we're all going to be judged the same. Well, this scripture right here says different. Maybe you need to read it. This is something to think about. Going on. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more.
You are holding a precious thing in you. The precious, precious presence and anointing of God. You must value that anointing. You must value it. The Word of God says that God is love. He expects you to just return the love. Just simply return the love. I've been sent here to proclaim the word in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. That the time has come that judgment must begin in the house of God. And if it first began at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? God will no longer allow his people to be led by darkness. You better get ready. A change is coming. You may not see it the way I believe it's going to come, but God is getting ready to let his people be led by righteous people. People who love him. People who are obedient to him. People who are not sneaking and creeping and slipping in darkness and coming in on Sunday morning acting like everything's all right. None of us are props, are what do they call those people? Palm readers or whatever. Any kind of gift that we have, it comes from God. So we can't read your mail unless God allows us to read your mail. We don't know what you're doing, but be sure your sins will find you out. God knows. So I'm here to warn you. Whoever this message is for, God has warned you and you have not given heed to his warning. But today, because of God's love for you, he has made provision for you to be set free if you will repent. There are no five steps here. I'm not going to have you writing it down, take it home and throw it aside because you're not reading it. All you need to do is repent. Amen. And God has come with his mercy and his presence to enable you to break free so that you can repent. And you have been warned to value what's inside of you.
Hi, this is Miss Preacher. Thanks for watching my video. I'd also like to tell you about John 3:16 that talks about God loving the world so much that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You are in this world and he is concerned about you. God loves you. Do you know that in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, the word says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So it all boils down to what's in your heart. That's what salvation is about. Inviting Jesus into your heart because you believe. And once you've invited Jesus into your heart, you pray to him, you seek him for guidance and protection, and he'll be there to help you. There's so many wonderful things about being saved. I'm not talking about joining a church. I'm talking about inviting Jesus into your heart and developing a personal relationship with him. Please consider inviting Jesus into your heart today. We want to make sure your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you for listening and have a great day.